Welcome in Amsterdam. This is the Eurocree Daily. We share your passion for hospitality excellence.
This talk on what I was asked to tell you on the origin and development of hospitality business starts around 1500, which the Dutch I'll do what I normally do at my university, because they don't have this expensive stuff. I just put a button. Okay, it starts around 1500 with the Dutch colour. You will never be, forget the word Dutch now after you have attended this conference. The Dutch colour, Erasmus, Desiderius Erasmus of Rotterdam. Am I starting with him? Firstly, because he is a so-called pre-alumnus. I invented this word especially for you today, of one of the universities that is organizing this Eurocree venue. Under the name of Gerrit Gerrits, he was a pupil of Deventer's Latin School for 6 years between 1478 until 1484. Then there was an outbreak of the Black Death and he was forced to fly to another school. And as I thought, as educators, you of course all know how grateful it is when your pupils do so well later on in life and even become famous. So I thought I should mention this. Of course, the second reason is the main reason that I start with Erasmus, since it entails the fact that he was an expert in the field of hospitality business. That's at least what I'm going to argue here. As a scholar, without a permanent job, he traveled widely. It is known that he wrote his treatise, his famous In Praise of Folly, on the back of a mule while traversing the Swiss Alps on his way from Italy to Thomas More in London. In his works, Erasmus commented many times on the quality of hospitality in France, England, Germany, and Italy. His good and bad experiences in the inns of his time, in combination with his inquisitive and restless mind, led him to reflections on the quality of life, I should say, as well as on the right way to live it, including the balance between work and rest. I will revert to this topic at the end of my talk. Let me first explore the coming into being of the concept of hospitality a bit more. As a concept, it is a medieval invention. Of course, in all cultures, people acted hospitably. But our present notion of hospitality, which implies a merging of materiality and immateriality, I think, aiming to create a feeling of welcome and homeliness, as I will argue throughout my talk, is a medieval construction. For that, I come back to Erasmus and his remarks on a theme. The best example is the picture he sketches of his experiences in hotels called inns in that time, in one of his written colloquies. They were, he complains, often noisy, overheated and badly ventilated, or too cold and draughty. You had to wait for hours until dreadful food was served. You paid far too much for far too little, but the worst thing, he says, was the rudeness of the innkeepers. They often hurled at you, he claims, when you don't like it, go somewhere else. End of quote. What Erasmus expresses here, I think, is a feeling of outright indignation. In his opinion, a guest has the right to feel at ease, at home, and ought to be made comfortable. One may conclude that he thought that hospitality business entailed more than just business. It can't exist by business alone, he's arguing. Probably Erasmus conveyed such irritation because in his days hospitality was considered to be a virtue. You can gather that from this picture of the master of Alkmaar, painted around 1520. The artist pictures the seven works of mercy, and they are: you have to satisfy the thirsty, feed the hungry, dress the naked, welcome pilgrims, visit the sick and prisoners, and bury the dead. This is a detail from the painting you were seeing before. These malardies, these are the guiding principles of every sincere Christian. The idea is the following, I should say. The basis of Christian society is caritas, charity. And what is caritas? That is the love for God, which articulates itself also in love for the other, especially in the form of care for those who are less fortunate than you are. The giving of food, drink, and shelter to the poor and needy, including travelers — that's what you see here to the right, are some travelers — is at the same time, of course, remunerative for your own soul. To formulate it very prosaic, and the Catholic Church doesn't like this formulation, but I think I should share it with you: by acting hospitable, you can earn credit points for coming into heaven. The system of mercy resulted in a wide-ranging hospitality industry. Here you see a 15th century hospital still existing. You can visit it. It's a museum nowadays. The Hôtel de Dieu of Beaune. It's in Burgundy. And I think that's important. You have the House of God, this is a church, but you also have the Hotel of God, and that is a hospital where you can receive ill people, poor people, but also travelers. And at the left, you see elements, again, of the works of mercy. There below, you don't, when being in the hospital industry, you don't think that much of that, but funerals is also part of hospitality business. At least that was the case in the Middle Ages. To make this clear, I propose, I think it's good to summarize a little bit what I meant. A quick look at the etymology of hospitality. You do have hospitals, almshouses for the poor, or hostels for pilgrims. It's the same word is used for that. Of course, a hostel is a guest. It's a stranger or foreigner. Hospitality is the relation between guest and shelterer. And so we are going to explore that. And then you have the several words. I could also have added inns, more spaces where hospitality takes place. Okay, let's move on. Originating in late antiquity, but fully blossoming in the late Middle Ages, is the custom of going on pilgrimage. It is closely related to the practices of hospitality and works of mercy. A pilgrimage was undertaken in case of